alaikum and welcome to Making a House a Home with myself, Sana Araji, and our guest, Fahima Muhammad, a qualified life coach and an NLP practitioner. Assalamu alaikum, Fahima.
Alaikum salam.
Now, today we're going to be discussing the topic around respect, manners and discipline, how we can implement it in the home and how we can maintain it.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just discuss a little bit about the topic for us?
Yeah, I'd like to start off by saying what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding our Prophet, peace be upon him, and the family. And I think it's really important because this highlights how we need to live, and we are definitely capable. And these are the examples that we need to learn from. So he says that by the mercy of Allah, our Prophet, peace be upon him, and his family, was mildly mannered with the people around him. And if he had been ill-mannered or hard-hearted, then they would have deserted him. So that alone shows that, you know, his characteristics and his virtues, even before prophethood, was of a particular way that actually gained him the success that he was, you know, required in, you know, having people's trust in him and having people, you know, turn to him and like him and even come towards him because of his mannerism. Even when he was faced with, you know, challenges and, you know, even enemies or whoever they may have been, he always kept to those characteristics and traits. And that's what we need to learn, that, you know, regardless of our situations, these things are really important to have within us. And yes, times have changed and, you know, interpretations have been, you know, differently evolved. But at the same time, those things are really important, which we are forgetting and we're taking for granted. And also Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, that, you know, there are four characteristics from the manners of our Prophet, peace be upon him and his family, and that was righteousness, graciousness, patience, and perseverance in tolerating misfortunes. And that rises the rights of the believer and elevates them. And I think it's really important that we need to instill that with us and within ourselves in this day and age, more importantly, because we forget. We take people for granted. We are in a mundane way of living, and we just sometimes forget ourselves as to how we behave. And Imam Sadiq alayhi salam also says that the prayer of the night, so Salat al-Layl, the night prayer, beautifies not just the face, but it also beautifies and, you know, sort of upholds your manners. And it also freshens, you know, your breath, and at the same time, it increases sustenance and it repels sorrows and strengthens your sight. So these things are really important. And even though we feel that, yes, we are, you know, quite well-mannered and we have discipline and respect, but we need to check ourselves because we need to see how other people's response to us are. And when we're in a family, especially living over so many, you know, months and years and through so many different, you know, struggles and things that we have to come across, you know, we can take people for granted. And it's so funny how when we are in our homes, we can actually mistreat someone without realizing it. But when we're outside, we will think twice. But actually, the home is the thing that needs to be really, really set in place and really important, because those are the people that have, you know, support and are actually relying on you, or you relying on them, or, you know, they need that, you know, sort of way of being so that they can actually have a good day. It's something as simple as that.
To build the foundations at home and to maintain it and to help them, I guess, like you're saying, to have a nice day and to...
Yeah, something
to
simple.
To maintain those the good values and akhlaq is very important.
Yeah, everyone's looking for happiness and they're looking for fulfillment. And, you know, if we have a partner or we have families, and when we come outside the house and we don't have that love and that support or the kindness even from the household, then, you know, it actually does sometimes reflect on the treatment, how we are with other people. And, or it could be the opposite, because we don't get it at home, we'll treat someone else outside really well, but we don't bring it to ourselves, you know, in the house. So there's many ways of looking at it. And, you know, the reason why I raised this topic is because it's just taken so lightly now, when actually, you know, if you were to just have respect between each other, then that can really extinguish anything that's about to come and happen, which is even something that, you know, there's going to be problem. Oh, they're not going to like something. But having that respect when you're talking to anyone, whether it's your sibling, whether it's your parent, whether it's a parent even talking to the child.
Yeah.
You showing your child respect. Even in Islam, it says you have to show respect in order to receive respect. Psychologists say the same thing. You know, it's not just, that's why I'm bringing the psychology into Islam, because whatever Islam says, you know, modern day psychology is saying that, but we're just not reading it. And we think that religion's backward and, you know, it doesn't really, it's not relevant to our days and life. But I'm showing how it really correlates, how it integrates, and how it actually is quite similar.
Yeah, subhanAllah. And we have the best of role models. Yes. Being followers of the Ahlul Bayt alayhum salam, we can look to them and we can adapt, like you're saying, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa ali, and he had so many good attributes. Yes. He was the trustworthy, the righteous.
Yes.
And also his offspring had that, similar attributes about them. But, going back to what you were saying about respect and manners, one of the things that drew me to the Ahlul Bayt, to follow the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, was the akhlaq of my husband. And if he wasn't a certain way, I wouldn't have divulged and gone to read about it, because there were certain things that I was seeing that, oh my goodness, how could an individual be like this? And then when I would read into it, I think, well, the Ahlul Bayt alayhum salam were so generous, were so kind, were so righteous. Their akhlaq was heavenly.
Absolutely.
When you think about this, we have a duty as Shia Muslims, followers of the Ahlul Bayt, to maintain that manners, respect and discipline, because that will draw people towards us.
Definitely.
As it did with myself, and I know many others as well.
Absolutely. The Imams were the perfect examples, even through adversity, through, when they were in prison, the guards befriended them.
SubhanAllah.
There's so many stories that actually say this, because of the way in which they treat us. We would be like, they hate us, and, they put us in this position, and we got to give the same treatment back. And, in this day and age, it happens. Mm. Even between, family members. If someone says something bad or, towards one another, the only way we want to do is respond by retaliating and doing the same. Mm-hmm. We don't want that to be said to us, yet we find that it's okay to do the same to someone else, and we think somehow that makes us better just because we're responding in the same way. That alone, if you actually say it out loud, it doesn't make sense. It's really hard, though. Mm-hmm. It's not easy as humans, especially now in this world, how everything is about, you're trying to up-one someone,
revenge.
Basically, or, being better than someone else and trying to have the better, way of saying something to make someone else feel down or low if they've done it to you. But by showing kindness, by showing mercy, by showing understanding and compassion, and even empathy towards the other side, even when they hurt you, that shows so much more that they can't respond to that, by the way. If it's very easy for each other to just start arguing and say the same things. But when one is actually saying something to you which is not necessarily nice, and the respondent is actually being, sort of like patient, listening, and actually not even responding, or if they do respond, they respond with kindness and understanding, the other person has to stop. Mm. They can't continue.
Mm.
So you actually teaching, you actually leading, and you actually in control. Because you're not falling into the way of which they're thinking, and you're not actually taking it personal either. You're just letting them, have what they need to say. But this is, again, it's a habit. It's a psychology as well as to how in which you take someone who is going to come and approach you in a negative way. How do you deal and respond with that? A lot of the times, even children don't know, which is very obvious, but adults don't even know. If anything, they just take it so personally. And even if it is personal, you don't need to allow it to attack you in that way. You are in control. We don't realize the control we have. But, our Islam and, our teachers, like our Prophet, peace be upon him, and the family, and the Imams, has shown us extreme examples of when they were in situations that they could deal with it, and how they persuaded and turned people from even the worst characteristics to the best because of their own manners.
SubhanAllah, yeah, very
so
true.
That is something that we need to consider. And as humans, we have got these unethical conducts, which is part of our habits and traits, and we think that basically, it's fine to seek revenge. It's fine to hurt someone because they've hurt us. It's fine to boast about somebody. There's so many things that we just don't realize, we take for granted, that, we just do in our daily lives because this is how we see in the media, this is how we see in, these reality shows, and this is how we are. We have to take into consider our environment and our surroundings in the way in which we live, with everything around us, which is outside the Islamic way that is influencing us. But we need to always come back down to our religion, to our ways, that is actually the way forward, that's actually going to bring us success.
Yeah, and bearing in mind, whilst you're doing these things, your children are watching.
Yes.
They're monitoring. They can see, they're so observant from such a young age.
Yes,
and so
absolutely.
They may start having those disrespectful attributes towards their siblings or their friends or even to their parents. So we need to be very careful what we say around the children, with other people, how we treat family members, making sure that we try to withhold the roots of the manners and the discipline and the respect in the household, inside the household and outside the household.
We need to understand what we give meaning to when it comes to manners, respect and discipline. Because just like wearing hijab, I had a show and a topic about hijab, and one of the main things that, you know, is translated, you know, and the meaning of hijab is not necessarily the outward garment, it's the akhlaq, and it's for everyone. It's the manners, you know, and that's what makes hijab. At the end of the day, we need to take that consideration. And when you come across, you know, men and women who may even dress in that particular way, but what comes out of their mouth, what comes out of them, you know, because that obviously is from their thoughts and in their actions, that is so contradictory to how they look. And I come across people coming to me complaints all the times, or, you know, I face with these challenges myself. You know, you speak the Arabic language, you do your salah, you go to Hajj, you do ziyarah, you give your charity, you fast, you know, go to majalis in Muharram. But then you're faced with a human that's going through something, and yet you want to either break a friendship, or you want to cause, you know, problems, or you want to speak bad about them, and you want to, you know, I don't know, whatever it may be. But, you know, to me, that's not religion. To me, that's not respect and manners. And you can take all of that on or off. It doesn't make sense to what we stand for. We need to be genuine and congruent and authentic to what we believe in. So what is it that we believe in? We need to question ourselves, and that needs to be relayed and represented in our daily actions, especially with people that we were faced with that we don't even like, that we don't even want near us. But do we actually cause more issues and problems because of that?
Very true.
That's lack of knowledge, lack of education, really, basic education, because even a child will know. You know, when you actually speak to children, they see it for how it really is, but we manipulate it to make it our own, just so that we feel good about treating someone badly because we've given ourselves a meaning and a reason. But actually, there's no reason and meaning to do any of that. It's just humanity, even humanitarian ways of looking at life as being good and kind and decent to another human being regardless.
Yeah.
And our religion even emphasizes that even more so. Manners is something that, you know, makes people, like you mentioned earlier, it's, you know, it draws them towards you in business, your family, your friends, everything. And it actually, you know, sets the actions and your destiny. And when you're working in a team, you don't have to stand out being arrogant, and you don't have to be the most, you know, loud and, you know, outwardly spoken personality. But just you being a particular way will draw the team towards you. You will be able to have that influence.
Very true,
if you know how and you be smart about it. We don't realize the power within manners and being disciplined. We always say as well, you know, with us, we don't have control. We don't have that discipline, even for ourselves, let alone we're teaching it to our children. Discipline is so important. And yes, it's mundane. Yes, it has to be also militant. But that sets the standard, that sets the level as to how we're going to move through our next stages and evolve and grow when we are put in a particular way. When you look at even, you know, in the military, or, you know, in schools or anything in companies, they have set rules which everyone has to follow. In every country, there are laws that we have to follow. So we have laws and rules within our religion that's so specific and set for our benefit, which is also highlighted, and it elevates us in so many ways, physically, mentally, our soul, you know, everything inside and out ourselves. So then why don't we actually use that between each other, you know, with our families, especially in our homes?
Very true. Like you said, we can have the most beautiful physical hijab, but we can have the most ugliest soul and intention.
And so it shows. It shows.
And it shows, like you said, subhanAllah. Yeah. And I was going to mention, with regards to manners and respect, now there are people from different cultures, different backgrounds, that have certain ways about them. And some people can get offended, but that is just how it is in their country.
Yeah,
it's normal.
Yes.
This is also an issue that I've heard a few friends, they've had experience with certain people from certain countries, and they think, oh, that's Abe, that's rude, why would they say that in such a way? But they're abrupt like that because it's normal in their country, with their spouse, with their children, it's their way of life. So we also need to consider the differences among us.
Even if you don't have understanding, and you don't have awareness. But we live in a world which, yes, it's huge, but actually it's quite close. You know, travel is really wide. We can Google stuff and we can see stuff. And living in a Western country like this, you have people from all over the world in one setting. And you may not even, you know, integrate with them, but you will hear or you'll see that, yes, there are differences in cultural manners and discipline and respect. And yes, it is it does differ between certain people. Like, some people will, you know, be more polite, and for others it won't be, and it's normal. And others will take it offensively. But, you know, having that understanding and not being judgmental can actually help you deal with this. But in the end, even if we think, oh yes, we're so well-mannered and our kids are so well-mannered, don't be boastful about it. Don't be high, you know, on your high horse about it. You know, understand that other people's, you know, education, knowledge and learning is for that level, for their, you know, surroundings at that moment in time. So just be understanding and do not judge them for it. If anything, you can question around it as to how things are, you know, what is it like, you know, in their environment, or learn about it. You know, a lot of these things are things that you can find out even on, you know, on the net. It doesn't really matter as to certain cultures, how they behave. So, and educate your children as well, because they obviously are influenced by the friends that they're around, and sometimes they can or they cannot help it. So they don't pick up on these things that we don't necessarily follow. So your home has to be solid so that, you know, you don't get scared as to what your children are exposed to. And it doesn't mean you've got to keep them only with the same clique, with the same group, with the same cultures constantly, constantly, constantly. They can go out and they can mix and mingle, and they can be the influence, because their way is the best way. Because that's what you've instilled in them, and that's what they follow. And they will see the results from it, which will show that, not just by speaking it and say, oh, well, my way is. It's the way in which, like you said, you were attracted by a certain way, you know, because that was attractive to you, the manners, you know. So if we have to build that within ourselves and people see it, and it's so easy, even just sitting silently, just the way in which you sit silently can make a huge difference, and people don't realize that.
Yeah, definitely. And it's so important, like you're saying, if it could attract people towards Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, just imagine if every person was doing that, how many people would become drawn. They will ask questions. You know, I have friends who, you know, will come and question me about certain things, and I guess who are not from the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, but they're so intrigued. Whereas there are other people from other schools of thoughts, if I go and ask them questions in a very polite way, they will be quite shut down and they'll be quite rude. And I think, well, hang on, I'm just asking you a question in a polite manner. Come on, show me a bit of respect. So we have these issues that are among on school runs with other mothers, even in the workplace among men. It is so common.
It is common. But, you know, again, we need to understand, you know, not just our beliefs and to do the rituals as we do year in, year out. We need to represent it. And you represent it in your behavior, in your conduct. And with that comes the manners, respect and the discipline. So that's what I'm trying to highlight. Don't just say you're followers of the Ahlul Bayt and you are a Shia and you love Imam Hussein alayhi salam and, you know, the rest of the Imams, when you yourself cannot have a nice word to say when you come home. Very true. Do not talk properly to any individual, especially in your home, because that does not represent what you say you love and you believe in. Now that's what's really important. You got to be congruent. You have to be real about who you are and be it. Yes, it's tough. We have days that we don't even like our partners, but we still got to show them respect. And, you know, we have to admit that. You know, we have troubles, and, you know, a household is the most important thing. We know that in Islam, the home is really important, but people are just so, they're not strong. They're not, you know, resilient, and they give up. And they just want to leave as soon as there's a, you know, struggles, and also any challenges that they face, they want to run away from, and they want to live life trying to avoid it, being comfortable, not wanting to get in between because it's family. But what about what's right and what's wrong? Because remember, you are going to be judged for that, and you're going to be judged individually. You have to stand up for what's right or wrong. Just like if even your own family member did something really unlawful and was faced in court, yes, you're going to support them. Yes, you're going to be by them, but you have to call them out on what is wrong and right. You know,
very true.
Educate that. But we don't do that. Just because you're a family member and a name doesn't mean you give all right to just, you know, do whatever it is and help them hurt someone else because you don't really, you know, want to get involved because that. No, people just want to be mediocre. They want to live average lives, you know, and they're happy with, you know, going out every now and again and having a good time with their friends. But at the same time, they're not changing themselves. They're not changing other people's lives because, you know, it's all about the self. I'm okay.
There's no progress.
My family's okay. You know, that's okay. But you know what? In order to progress in life, that's where there's only 3% of people in this world who are top 3%. Okay. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, it's only that small amount, psychologists have said, because, you know, they actually want to go out there and make a difference. Mm. They want to go beyond boundaries. Even when it comes to their own family members, they need to speak up and they need to talk about what's really right and wrong first and what's just, and, you know, follow that within themselves and for the rest of the family.
Inshallah. Thank you. That's a good note to end at. Thank you very much, Fahima. Unfortunately, we need to go for a break, but inshallah, we'll come back and we'll answer some of the viewers' questions. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to the second part of Making a House a Home, where we've been discussing manners, respect and discipline. Now, we're going to answer some of the questions from the viewers. Inshallah, if you can answer that for us, Fahima.
Mm-hmm.
Our first viewer is Ammar, and he says, can you give a tip on how to instill respect between family members so despite differences in opinion, the communication is civil, without offence and respect is maintained?
Well, it's very simple in a sense to say that whatever you're going to vocalize, whatever you're going to communicate, make sure. Mm-hmm. I mean, Imam Ali alayhi salam has so many hadith that you can look on. And the golden rule is, you know, say what you would like to be said to you. Do what you would like, you know, that you would want the responder to be towards you. You know, it's like putting yourself in a situation where you feel if, you know, if I wouldn't like being spoken to in that way, if I wouldn't like those words being told to me, even if I was wrong, I want to be, you know, spoken to with respect, you know, because that's when you're going to listen to somebody.
Mm.
Even as parents, when they are right, if they're going to approach their child in a particular way, they're not going to get that, in, you know, the response that they want. They're not going to get that learning and the moral out of a story that they've done wrong if they don't approach it in the right way. So you have to be careful and take yourself out of the situation. If it's like in the moment and it's heated, you know, sometimes we want to deal with everything at that point. We can't. We need to go away, sit back, take time out, reflect. Reflection is so important so that we don't just get heated in the moment. You know, to pause. Even they say in Islam, you know, when you're angry, drink water, do wudu. You know, if you're standing, sitting, if you're sitting, lay down. All of these things help. And we don't practice that. We definitely don't. If anyone comes to us, we pounce back straight away and we do it within seconds. But that's really, really dangerous. And if we don't have control over ourselves, how do we expect to even influence and teach and even have anyone else respect us?
Mm.
It's very difficult. Yes, it is. But it's a habit that I work with people that they can actually manage their anger. They can manage their stress levels. They can manage having control over situations that is like challenging, over situations that is overbearing, you know, over situations that they're not happy with, over situations that, you know, is really like pushing them to their limits and boundaries and taking them out of their comfort zone. All of these things, especially in NLP, you know, neuro-linguistic programming, it really helps individuals cope with a lot of these things. And this is everyday life challenges that, you know, as individuals, we ignore, we think, you know, there's no rule book as to how to live and be and, you know, and how to create in a particular way. But actually there is in psychology and in our religion, but we're not reading it correctly and we're not interpreting it in the right way. And we're using it as to what's halal, what's haram, what's lawful, what's not, and what's supposed to be done and what's not, but how to engage with people, how to maintain with people good relationships, how to treat people so that you actually become that influence, you become that voice, that, you know, that learning, that teacher. We need to all be all of this. We need to be leaders. We need to be masters in our field, not just professionally, but in our households. Mm. How wonderful is that if we actually aspire to do these things? But we don't. We think getting married, having fun, having a partner. Yes, we can go out, we can have freedom, we have that. And then all of a sudden when the honeymoon period is over or over years, we get bored and things change and people evolve separately and they go their separate lives. Oh, it doesn't work for me. So, you know, we need to move on or we cannot deal. And if challenges happens in the family, oh, you know, they're just being unreasonable or, you know, they're not listening to my point of view. No, why are you judging someone else? You be that change. Mm. You be that someone that you want to hear in someone else. Practice it yourself.
Yeah.
You know, have family meetings, you know, talk about these things openly as to, you know what, that's not respect. What is your meaning of respect? We also have an idea in like language. We all have, we speak in metaphors. For example, you know, there is light at the end of the tunnel. For me, it means one thing. For you, it means something else. Don't just assume.
Yeah, very
find
true.
Out what exactly does it mean to you to have manners and respect? Because we assume there's one way of speaking, but actually there's, you know, there's several ways of interpreting it.
Mm.
So you've got to understand each other. And over time, that even changes. So your families are changing. You know, different things affect them. What affected, you know, me last year or the year before, it's not going to affect me the same now. You're going to learn about each other constantly in your family. Mm. We're living together constantly, but we're having separate lives, you know, going to school, going to work, having different influences, having different people and friends around us constantly. And we're changing in that time, but when we come home, we don't share that. So that conversation and that learning about how each other, you know, is evolving is not being shared, so that we don't know each other, even though we've lived for years. And that's where the problem is.
Yeah, definitely. And would you say, for example, if a discussion between family members gets a bit heated, withdrawing yourself from the discussion, perhaps going, doing some breathing techniques, mindfulness,
absolutely,
calming yourself down so that you can think clear when you're reacting to them instead of just abruptly and out of anger,
yeah,
and revenge?
Absolutely. And not just that, we need to be more logical thinkers. A lot of the times we roll with our emotions, especially as women. And I know that. And, you know, there is a difference between men and women, and we can get heated up. And also with certain cultures, there's expectation. You've got to understand and lower your expectation, and you've got to be more merciful towards each other. You need to be more lovable and kind, even when you that person's being horrible to you. And do not go with your emotion initially. Yes, say what you have done has made me feel this way. Not you have caused, or I am feeling this way. There's a way in which you talk which makes yourself out of that situation, and you're not actually also blaming the other person for their entire personality when they've said one or two things, because that's not all them. That's the other thing. We will have some disagreements, and there are moments in life where we are going to disagree, but then we create that person as being a whole on that particular one thing that they've said. For example, you know, if someone said something bad to me, I'm gonna, you know, elevate that to say that's that whole person in that way of being, and they're not. Right. It's just in that moment. But then we take it so personal, and we become so emotional instead of being logical and say, they said this at that time for this. Let me take responsibility as well as to why they came across to that way of thinking, being, and behaving and speaking to make them feel like that. What is it that I did? When you do it like that, it is so different. And even if they were wrong, but you addressing it in that particular way makes it balanced, makes it fair and just, and you also coming closer. You know, they taking a step and you're taking a step, and you both come. And believe me, that alone, it actually wakens someone else up. Even when they heat it, it cools them down.
Yeah, inshallah. And I guess that's why they say having a third party who's not biased, doesn't have an emotional attachment to either one, would think more logically and clearly.
And unfortunately, it doesn't really happen though with members of families. That's the thing. That's why coaching is so necessary, because it's non-directive, it's non-biased and judgmental. And we are outsiders coming in purely for the sake of, you know, what needs to be, without any direction as to which family member feels a particular way or has some, you know, inside information from the past which can influence, you know, in the way in which of thinking and being. We just enter a situation, we solve it without having to know the past, not even like counselors, because counseling goes into the past. No, coaching doesn't do that. It's for the moment there and then. And I think coaching to even, you know, come in together when we do have some deep rooted problems within family members, that they don't even talk to their own brothers and sisters for years, or they've split up, you know, cousins and relatives. And that is so wrong in a way of living to go forward. So, you know, it can actually help to seek some outside help, which is really going to be, you know, useful and vital to you.
Okay, thank you very much. Inshallah, that helps our dear brother Ammar. The second viewer we have is Sarah, and her question is, what are the best ways of teaching siblings to uphold respect between each other so they will actually display this amongst them?
Yes, again, you know, as parents, we have to show it ourselves as how we treat each other. And like you said before, they also replicate what they see. So if they see parents not speaking to each other, you know, spouses between the mum and dad not speaking, you know, in a respectful way, then they sort of relay that with each other. But on the other hand, you know, even when children do see the respect around them, they will just use what they need to use because they're experimenting and they get heated and they're just learning and they're different stages and phases. And you need to guide them and support them as to the outcome, because, you know, we all have freedom of choice, even as children. You know, you can tell them whatever you want to tell them, but they will choose what they need to do. But what you need to advise them is not just about the freedom of choice, but the consequences of those choices that they make. So being a particular way, this is what it leads to, you know, and being a particular way, this is what it benefits to. You need to educate them. You need to become, again, coaching parents. I'll probably hear me say that constantly. But when you have that awareness of how to teach, how to influence, and a lot of the times being a parent is not about just giving information. It's about influencing them. You have to be a leader in your family. Mm. And leadership is not being authoritative. Mm. It's about being a particular way yourself and attracting and being inviting to whoever's around you in that household, especially your children, so that they actually come to you and look at you as a role model. So it's a big responsibility. It is also a very much a skill and a talent. Don't take it lightly that just because you're of a certain age, you can get married, you can have kids and job done. No, it is a skill, it's a talent. Yeah. And if you want to do being successful, you need to learn those skills and the techniques and those strategies so that you can actually perform in the way you need to and get the results. So, you know, advise them as to what are the consequences, look at different examples, you know, see how other people have done it. And, you know, if they've done it in the wrong way, this is what happens. Mm. And I'm sure the kids themselves have seen it. And it's repetition, it's practice, it's you constantly even reminding them, showing them in various ways. And they themselves don't like to be, you know, treated as if they were treated badly, so, you know, if they were treating someone else badly. So, you know, it's the same thing, it's reverse psychology as to whether or not, you know, they would like to be treated in that way. So why are they treating that? And also to bring about the fact that family relationships are so important that even though people love their friends, that blood relative is so powerful. Mm. Not to say that you cannot have family outside because we choose our friends and they become family.
Yeah.
But at the same time, when you are in a family, you know, you need to create that bond to say, you two are together. When mom and baba is not here in the house or wherever it may be, you two need to build that security so you can rely on each other, not just as children, but when you become teenagers and adults. Yeah. And that's the first point of contact, first point of friendship. You know, have these sort of ways of talking with your children so that they actually understand what they've got, what the value is of having a brother or a sister. It's not just someone else, another member that's just popped up one day and they got to deal with it. No. It's extra strength, it's extra support. It's another real best friend who's gonna be there to support you no matter what. So build that friendship.
Mm. Obviously children, depending on ages, children generally do fight and they have.
Yeah, you gotta allow it too.
Yeah, they.
You gotta allow it as well. But at the same time, but not to the extent where it becomes a habit because slowly you gotta wind them, you know, wean them out of it too. Mm. Because, you know, don't just also be like blasé about it and say, oh, well, you know, kids fight, do this, do that. Because in the end, they're going to end up doing that as adults and then it's serious. And it has happened. Brothers fight, you know, fist fight. I've had stories of this where they do not have the respect for another. And they do actually have these sort of, you know, relationships, which is really toxic. And the parents have no control because now they're adults and they're carrying on this way and they separate from each other. They won't talk to each other. They won't sit with each other. They won't mingle in that way. They won't have a family, you know, sort of setting because from a young age, it was taken lightly. And now they've carried it forward into, you know, adulthood. So you've got to know when to put that block. And to be honest, even though, yes, kids fight and argue, but again, if you instill that manners and respect, it will wind down where it does not, you know, elevate and escalate into something which is normal because it's not.
Yeah, inshallah. Thank you for that. And inshallah, hopefully that helps our dear sister Sara. The next viewer we have is Saad. And the question he's asking is, some cultures do have their own ways of behaving. And these customs are practiced for generations and causes offense in some cases. Mm-hmm. Like if a practicing Muslim woman refuses to shake a man's hand in a work environment, then it can be seen as quite rude.
Yeah.
How can one act on the principles of Islam and today's Western society? This is a very common issue.
Yes.
Even I've had issues with this.
Yes.
I'm sure a lot of Muslim women have.
And
had
how would you deal with something like that?
To be honest, the first time I just shook hands because I didn't know what to do.
Okay.
Then gradually the second time I kind of just became a bit withdrawn and put my hands down and just kind of nodded my head. And then I think when it started to get more repetitive, I would then say to them, do you know what? I would politely say to them, like, I'm not being disrespectful or rude, but just part of my belief is that I'm not part of my belief and I'm not comfortable with just shaking hands with the opposite sex.
Mm-hmm.
That was difficult for me to say because me, myself, I found that really rude because I'm thinking, well, they don't understand the religion. How can you, like, how can you let them know without them thinking that Islam is a sexist religion, because automatically they think, oh, well, women don't have rights.
Okay, just hearing you speak now, I feel like I'm in a coaching session right now.
Yeah. Go ahead.
But to be honest, firstly, you got to be confident about what you believe in. Mm. And yes, even though you are trying to understand how it may come across to somebody else, but if you are confident into what you believe in and you bring that across, and of course, there's different situations and scenarios and it will differ. Mm. But in this particular one, say, for example, if you're at work,
yeah.
you know you're going to be approaching that every single day. And, you know, if you're going for an interview, you can always find out, you know, is it going to be a male or female that's going to be interviewing me? If it's a male, say, look, I don't want to be rude, but can you inform the interviewer? You know, there's so many steps you can take that, you know, I am from this culture, I'm from this background, and I don't want to be rude to him, but, you know, I will not be shaking hands. Or if you feel that you cannot do that, you're not brave enough to do that, then, you know, you can wear gloves, you can, you know, do whatever you want, but you've got to be prepared and you've got to be strong. And even though you know it may come across as rude, you've got to be confident to show them that it is not rude that I'm being. Because sometimes you feeling a particular way can make the other person feel it. That, again, is psychology. You got to be so tough in your mind, no matter what you do and how you see yourself, because people see you as you see yourself. So as you were talking, you were really, you know, like sort of making yourself feel a little bit ashamed and, you know, embarrassed and a little bit held back. And that person can feel those vibes and that aura. So in a way, it's like, are you really sure that you believe what you believe in? Or is it just you being forced? That's why we're always told that we are oppressed.
Very
because
true.
We're not coming across like as if, no, this is me. I choose not to do that. You know, I don't want to do that. I'm going to come across to you with respect, and I'm going to respect you probably more than anyone else. And that handshake would not mean nothing.
Mm.
You know, but it shows that I actually respect you more because I'm keeping my distance. And, you know, in the workplace, it's the most understandable thing right now because you know how with everything that's happening with men and women and just one bad look, they can go into HR and complain.
Yeah.
So if anything, you're doing them a favor.
Yeah.
Okay. But you expressing in a particular way makes you that individual that stands out, and you don't need to feel guilty. You don't need to feel, you know, anything. So you got to be confident yourself in no matter what you say or do, but you got to believe it because people can tell in your voice that energy you put out there is so important, especially us as women wearing hijab. It doesn't matter what you wear, what comes out of here because it's over there first, that relays a different story because I know I said in many settings, people are scared, you know, look at me, innocent, small face, whatever it may be, but when I speak, it's powerful because your belief is powerful because your passion is genuine and it's strong, and that only comes from you actually believing what it is that you're doing is right, so that you don't even believe it for yourself, you actually convince them. Now that's the difference, and that is something which we need to do with everything and every stage in our lives. And if each individual was to carry that forward, I think we'll be in a different world. We don't need to have to prove ourselves or, you know, explain it in a particular way for approval. We're just doing it because this is me. You're going to do what you're going to do, and that's you. And that's perfectly okay, too. Yeah. And that's how you got to come across. Yes, we got to consider other people's ways, but not because it's going to change our way of being. No. Mm. We are showing, you know, what we represent. We are showing there's a reason and a meaning behind it. Not just beneficial for me, but beneficial for you, too.
Yeah.
You know, to have that distance. To have that. So if anything was to even come out later on, I'm saying, well, there's definitely never going to be any contact between us. There's not going to be any issues like that. We're going to concentrate on our work and we're going to do our work because there's never going to be that line crossed, ever. You know, I'm just giving examples as to how it can, you know, basically carry forward because it starts with you having that strength and belief in what exactly that you actually are doing. And you transfer that in many ways.
Inshallah, thank you. And I guess don't sacrifice your values and your belief for the sake of pleasing other people.
Absolutely.
Withhold
onto
it and be confident.
Absolutely.
Inshallah, hopefully that helps a lot of sisters because I know that is a bit of an issue with some sisters. They do find that a bit difficult. But inshallah, that with your advice, that should help them. And our final viewer is Manar. And the question they are asking is, kindly explain ways to deal with children and teenagers who now view respect in a different way and think that it is okay to answer back, for example. So how can this kind of behavior be changed?
That is a very good question. And we are living in an epidemic where we have insecure parenting because it's all about, you know, how the children feel, which is great. You know, we need to consider that and they're becoming more expressive, but that's actually taking over the fact that we have less control. Again, we're not confident as to what our rights are as parents and the reasons why we have these rights upon them, just like how they have the rights upon us. And the rights we have as parents is to make sure that they are brought up in a particular way for their future. And that will entail being disciplined, having manners, having respect, having to conform to certain rules and regulations in that household before you go out and play, before you go and do certain things, before you even get a reward. Mm. And we have an issue now because a lot of mums, you know, are working and they have that guilt because I'm not in the home. Then when we come home, they can just let loose and be free and do what they want because that makes us feel good because we weren't there. You don't need to be there. But even if you're not there, you give them quality time if you plan it and manage it well, but you still have a responsibility to bring them up with these strict rules and regulations, and don't be afraid to use that. Mm. Because if you are, you know, when they're young, it's okay. When they get older, you lost. You have no control. They're not going to listen to you. So you've got to bring that up really strong and strictly from a young age, if possible. Or even if you're just starting now and you've let go, say, listen, we're changing things now. I'm seeing that it's not working for us. It's not working for you. You're not, you know, studying, or you're not, you know, getting the best out of your life. I want you to have the best for you. Not even about me. Not to have say, oh, well, I didn't have this and I don't. No. Every day and age and every stage, you know, you can have the best life and quality, but it takes 10 years to be an overnight success. You know, that's how you got to talk to them. It takes 10 years. Mm. There's no such thing as you doing it from now. So we're planning your future from now. You be disciplined. You be, you know, respectful. You be honest. You listen to your parents, because sometimes, you know, they disregard the fact that we have the experience. We've been through certain things. Yes, times are moving. Things are modern. But the same rituals are the same. You don't work hard. You don't do the work. You don't actually, you know, put effort in. You're not going to get the result. It's not going to come to you like that. So you need to be careful to know that you are a parent who is strong, who is going to be someone who is going to, you know, have that sort of like, you know, influence on your child, you know, where you can be someone that they look up to, you know. And yes, they can express themselves, but they express it with respect, because they don't personally, especially when I know with teenagers, they all want respect. My parents don't respect me. My teachers don't respect me. Society doesn't respect me. They look at me as a teenager and someone that's on the street, that's a hoodie or whatever it may be. Why is that? But you show them the respect and say, well, you'll get that respect if you are a particular way, and I'm training you for it. And these are the steps, these are the stages. Don't be afraid to use it. And yes, it's tough. Yes, it's not nice. But you know what? It's okay. We need to sometimes also know that life, you don't have to be motivated and driven in order to do something. You just still got to do it. But the results in the end will give you that reward. We can't see all the results straight away. Like I said, it takes 10 years to become successful. It doesn't just happen like that.
Yeah.
You listen to all these role models, even in celebrities who are basketball players, footballers, you know, whatever celebrity they come from. You look beyond their story. See who your child, you know, actually looks up to in this day and age, in this world. It may not even have to be a religious figure. You know, look at these people. And if you look and listen to their stories, it does come from hard work. And they aspire to be footballers. They aspire to be, you know, someone on TV or wherever it may be. Mm. It doesn't just happen. It's not just luck. And even if it is luck, like how you see on these, you know, reality shows, those lucks don't last. But if it's going to be lasting long, it's the hard work, consistent hard work. So you've got to strive to be that kind of parent that's going to show them that this is what life is really about. And there's tough days. There's some really tough days out there. But you know what? I'm there to support you. And I'm going to give you that push and that kickstart that you need when you don't feel like it. But you got to be on it, and you got to be on point. So this is how you got to talk, and this is how you got to be. Sure. And inshallah, you know, your children will respect you, and they will also have respect as well for others around them, and they will conform.
Inshallah. Thank you so much for that, Fahima. Unfortunately, again, we've come to the end of the show of such a great topic. I really do hope the viewers have benefited from the discussion, inshallah, and you can implement it into your daily lives. And we'll see you again for another episode of Making a House a Home. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.